verses 38 and 39 in the beginning. Very, very famous portion of scripture. And Sister Tina, would you mind going on just a moment? And I misunderstood. I thought the party was at the church.
Except for Judas Iscariot, who had already taken his own life, but he was replaced, amen, with another. The Bible says that all of the disciples were there, but let's read on just a moment. This may shock you just a moment. It said, these all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women, and Mary, the mother of Jesus, with his brethren. Amen. I know that there's been an argument for years about whether Mary spoke in tongues as the Spirit gave the utterance, because she was already filled with the Holy Ghost, the Bible said. But I want you to look per the Word, per the Scripture, per Acts chapter 1, that Mary, the mother of Jesus, was also present on the day of Pentecost when they were filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. So let me say this, and then I'll prove to you that Mary was filled with the Holy Ghost. If Jesus required that his mother be filled, the one who he loved more than any other, then why would we, as a people, as a Gentile dispensation, be exempt? She wasn't, and neither are we. We've got to have it. I want it. I need it. And I'm going to have it.
Amen.
Amen. I've got to have the Holy Ghost. You've got to have the Holy Ghost. Amen. If we're going to be saved, you say, well, preacher, prove to me that Mary received the Holy Ghost. Okay, I just showed you in Acts chapter 1 where Mary was in the upper room. Correct? Anybody dispute that? Are we all on the same page? Mary was there. She was in the upper room. Let's go to Acts chapter 2, verse 1. You already know where I'm going. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all, including Mary, in one accord, in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it set upon each of them, or all of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues. I feel the Holy Ghost right now. As the Spirit gave them utterance. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to tell you that as important as it was on the day of Pentecost for even the mother of Jesus Christ to receive the Holy Ghost, that it's still important for the church of God today to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gives the utterance. And that is the initial sign and evidence of the Holy Ghost. Amen. I'm going to get a little crazy here in just a moment. Amen. The Bible said that the Holy Ghost is for us. I've been asked many times that the Holy Ghost is for me. Acts 2 and 39 through 47. Listen, for the promise is unto you, and to your children, and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. And then they that gladly received his word were baptized. And the same day were added unto them about 3,000 souls. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, and in breaking of bread and prayer, and fear come upon every soul. And many wonders and signs were done by the apostles, and all that believed together and had all things common. And they sold their possessions and goods and parted them to all men as every man had need. And they continued daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house. And did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. Can I tell you that the will of God is for every man to be filled with his precious anointing, and it's for every man to be filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And those that go glad to receive his word shall be baptized, and they shall be filled. Well, that is the word of God. Hallelujah. I'm trying not to preach too hard right now, but I feel the Holy Ghost in this house. Amen. When the scripture talked about going from house to house, that was witnessing, by the way. Amen. If we're going to be the disciples and the apostolics, we got to witness. I want to tell you something. I don't mean to discredit any of this, because I think it's all good in modern media and all of those things. I'm thankful for it. I'm thankful that we don't have to send by a post rider on the Pony Express anymore, that we can just pick out our phone and shoot a text message across town and say, hey, Jack, are you okay? I sat out a few of them last night, and I'm thankful for that. But I want to tell you that tracts, cards, and mail outs are not biblical, but going door to door, knocking on it, and breaking bread is exactly what the apostles done, and that is biblical. So no matter how many mail outs, flyers, or text messages we send, if we're going to be the true apostolic church, we still got to knock on some doors and ask somebody, hey, have you heard about the Holy Ghost? Hey, have you heard about the miracles of Jesus? Amen. This world don't know about Jesus. How do we expect them to ever hear if we're not willing to tell them, hey, there's something better than what you got, and his name is Jesus?
Oh,
hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Goodness gracious, I feel the Holy Ghost in this place right now. How do I receive the Holy Ghost? That's the simplest part of all of this. The Bible said, Acts 2:38, then Peter said unto them, who? Those that were convicted in their heart. Verse 37 said, when they heard of this, they were pricked in their heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, what must I do? And it was Peter that spoke up and said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now let me just stop just for a moment and get off on baptism just for 30 seconds in case somebody's listening. I'm not trying to start an argument. I'm not trying to start a dispute. But I tell you what I will do. I'll give you everything that I own, as meager as it may be. If you can find me one place in anybody other than John the Baptist after Acts 2:38 baptized in any other name than the name of Jesus, I'll even quit preaching and give you everything that I've got. Every time that you find them baptized, they put them down and baptize them in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. And the Bible said, ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. It's not open for debate. It's not optional. If you do it the right way and you do your part, God will do my Lord. But I'm going to tell you something tonight. You're going to let me slow down just for a couple of moments. If you're waiting for God to chicken flip you up out of your seat and grab you by the tongue and rip the Holy Ghost into you, you are grossly misunderstanding what tongues are for. Hello, let me tell you something. I've been serving God a long time. I've been preaching for 24 years. And I ain't never had God reach into my mouth and grab my tongue and go to rattling. I ain't never had God do that. I had to open my mouth and speak faith. I had to open my mouth and let the Holy Ghost fly out. Let me tell you something. If you wondered how to speak in tongues, you've got to open your mouth and you've got to let the anointing and the utterings of God come forth. And that's the only way you're going to do it. God's not going to peel your head apart and say, you're going to speak in tongues, Jack. That God just wants us to do our part. And our part is by praise and worship of the King of Kings.
Amen.
Amen. Tongues are not, first of all, nor will they ever be the Holy Ghost. Oh, I just knocked some of you out, didn't I? Amen. Any of you that have been taught that tongues are the Holy Ghost, you was taught wrong. Tongues are not the Holy Ghost. Tongues are the evidence of the Holy Ghost. They are the sign of the Holy Ghost. Amen. I want to tell you something that you can't just walk around saying I'm a Christian any more than you can go around saying you're a doctor without the evidence. You're just going to not be able to substantiate those claims. If I walk out tonight and said, trust me, I'm a brain surgeon, how many's going to let me cut on your head after church? Nobody, not one of you. Hey, not one person. If I tell you that I'm a leg surgeon, how many's going to let me cut on your leg after church? You know why? Because I ain't got no evidence. I haven't proved it. You haven't seen the report. You haven't seen the evidence. You haven't seen the signs. Ladies and gentlemen, when we begin to tell people that we got this real apostolic anointing, you better be sure that there's some signs behind it. You better be sure that there's some evidence behind it. And the evidence of the infilling of the Holy Ghost is and will always be speaking Spirit gives the utterance.
Hallelujah.
Amen. When we proclaim to have the real deal, we better be able to produce the evidence. Amen. You claim you're from Spain all you want to, but until you habla español.
Come on. Come on.
You can say you're from France. If you're blue in the face, you walk around telling everybody, oh, monsieur, I'm French. But if you don't parle le français,
come on.
Hey, yeah. What am I trying to say? If you don't speak the language, baby, you ain't from there. And if we tell everybody that we're from heaven and that we're ambassadors, we better be able to speak the language and back it up. Because if we don't, I want to tell you, we're no more than just imposters and posers. We're nothing more than just some wannabes. When we tell people we're an example of what Christ ought to be, we better be able to back it up. And we better be able to talk the talk.
Hallelujah. Praise
God. Amen. My Jesus, I felt the Holy Ghost now. Amen. Likewise, we can't claim to, we can lay claim to Jesus all we want to, but if the proof is not there and the proof is speaking like Jesus. Amen. Somebody asked me one time, said, you know, the reason I don't speak in tongues is I'm afraid I'd sound funny. And I said, you know what, every baby I've ever held sounded funny when they first started.
That's right.
Hello?
Come
Every baby, my little girl tingles the fire out of me. Everything she, well, when I said this evening, we were sitting over the house, and I had her sitting in my lap. And I said, can you say Christmas tree? And she said, tree. And I said, no, say Christmas tree. And she said, kiss, kiss, tree. She sounded funny, but you know what? She was doing the best that she could. There's times that I'll say something to her, and I know, ain't no doubt in my mind, she ain't understanding one bit of it. She'll look at me just spraying, and I'll say, yep. Yeah. Yeah. And I know she don't understand because she didn't do nothing. And there's also times that I'll say something to her, she'll say, no. And I know that she ain't listening to me. I know that she don't know exactly what I'm saying because no is not the appropriate answer. But what am I trying to say, ladies and gentlemen? When you begin to talk in the spirit, I'm here to tell you that you don't need to sound like an adult. You're a baby in Christ. And so you need to sound like a babe. And you need to act like a babe. And you need to worry about your wounds and cops. What you need to worry about is the anointing of God coming on you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. Well, I'll sound, I won't get it right. Oh, really? I didn't realize that there was a protocol. I didn't get the memo. Amen. I've heard people speak in tongues all my life, and I've heard it different. I'm going to tell you what. I've seen people tie their tie. I've seen them sell them a Honda by a Yamaha. I'm telling the gospel truth. My daddy pastored the church in the Delta, and God rest her soul. She's dead now. But every time she spoke in tongues, I counted them. There was no doubt in my mind that she spelled medicine. Now, she'd say, Imidi-I-C-I-N-E, Imidi-I-C-I-N-E. And every now and then, she'd really get in the spirit. And she started to Imidi-I-C-I-N-E. And I thought, man, I know exactly what that spells. But I want to tell you something. Don't you ever discount or discredit what God is moving upon and what God is doing. Ladies and gentlemen, there is no protocol. There is no word and syllable that is exactly right. What matters is that you are willing to open your mouth and let God speak through you. And let God say, oh my God, I feel the Holy Ghost right now. I wish that somebody in this house would just get in turn to God without their disciples and say, Lord, I'm just willing to be a vessel for your anointing. God, I'm just willing to be a vessel for your anointing. Lord, I'm just willing to be a vessel that you can use. I come to this place today. That is something of my power of the Holy Ghost. Amen. We don't need any fruit inspectors. We don't need people walking around talking about, I don't know if they got the Holy Ghost because I didn't hear them. The last I checked, it ain't up to you to know. It's up to God to know, and it's just up to me to raise my hands and rejoice with them that rejoice and say, my God, they've done it, and they're satisfied with it. It's not up to me to say who did and who didn't.
That's right. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, lift your hands right now. Thank the Lord for the Holy Ghost. Lord, I thank you for your presence. I thank you for that sweet Holy Ghost, Jesus. Lord, I thank you for that power that comes down from heaven.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Be seated for just a second. I got a few more scriptures to back up what I was just talking about. About how it don't have to sound right. Or it don't have to sound like somebody else thinks. Amen. Romans chapter 8 and verse number 26 said, likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. There's times in your life when your spirit is so perplexed and you go down to an altar and you can't even speak, you can't even say anything. But all you can say is, oh God, all you can have is those groanings. And the Spirit, the Bible said, is interceding for you. Don't you ever discredit that. Don't you ever discount that. That you let God speak through those groanings and utterings. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 10 through 14 said that God hath revealed to them, unto us by his Spirit, for the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knoweth the things of what knoweth the things of man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so, the things of God knoweth no man, but the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit of God, that we might know the things that are freely given unto us of God. Which things also we speak, not in the words of which man's wisdom teacheth, but with the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolish unto him. Neither can he know them, because they are not spiritually discerned. Can I tell you that when your spirit begins to intercede, and your spirit begins to talk, it's not time Corinthians chapter 14, verses 1 through 2 says, follow after charity and desire spiritual gifts, but rather that you may prophesy. For he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto God. For no man understandeth him, howbeit in the Spirit he speaketh mysteries. Can I tell you that when you're speaking in tongues, you're not speaking to one another, but your spirit is speaking to God. Your spirit is talking to Him. It's time that we stop telling God what we need, and it's time that we get into a place of worship, and it's time that we get into a place of prayer, and go beyond the norm and find that place where our spirit begins to speak to God. It's then and there that things will change, and it's then and there that things will be anointed. And when we find that place of intercessory prayer, our spirit will begin to intercede on our behalf, and it'll say thanks to God that the flesh cannot. When our spirit is ignited by His Spirit, I want to tell you that's when the Holy Ghost begins to speak.
Oh, amen.
Acts chapter 10, verse 44 through 48 said, while Peter yet spake these words, this is the Holy Ghost way, this is the apostolic way, while Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on all them which heard the word, and they of the circumcision which believed were astonished, and as many came with Peter, because on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost, for they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. And then Peter said, can man forbid them water, that they should not be baptized, they which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. And then they prayed him to tarry certain days. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to tell you something. If it was good enough for Peter, it's good enough for me. If it was good enough for the apostolic church, it's good enough for me. If it was good enough for Acts, it's good enough for me. And if it was good enough for my granddaddy and my daddy, it's good enough for me. All I want is this old-fashioned apostolic outpouring of the Holy Ghost.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Amen. Acts chapter 19, verse 6 said, and when Paul had laid his hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came upon them, and they spake with tongues. Amen. Anybody believe they received the Holy Ghost? It's time for us to open our mouth and by words and syllables speak with other tongues as the Spirit gives the utterance. The Holy Ghost will give the utterance, but you got to do the talking.
Yes, sir. Come on.
Come on, I may cross your philosophy, but you can't prove me wrong with the Word of God. Your voice, you've got to be the voice. The Holy Ghost may give the utterance, but your voice, you've got to yield. You've got to open your mouth. You've got to be the vessel. You've got to allow God. Amen. And you're not supposed to understand it. Quit trying to understand what's going on. Quit trying to understand what's happening in the words that are coming out. And just know that your spirit is crying unto God, and your spirit is blessing God, and your spirit is being ignited by the One who made all of this possible and spoke this world into existence. I wish somebody would clap your hands right now. Hallelujah. Let's stand. I told you I wasn't going to be very long. Amen. I wish that all of our church would have been here, and I know that it wasn't possible. I know that we've got sick folks. I know that we've got people that couldn't be here. I understand that. Amen. I wish the entire church would have been here to hear this tonight. We got it wrong. We think that everything's got to be perfect. We think that everything's got to be just exactly like we want in the flesh before we're baptized with the Holy Ghost. The Bible tells us that if we will truly repent of our sins, that God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins.
Yes, sir.
And when we are baptized by immersion in the name of Jesus, that the remission of sins takes place, and God begins to wash them away and cover them with His blood. And I want to tell you, from that point on, the Bible said it's a done deal, it's a deal breaker, that ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Well, preacher, I've seen people baptized and not receive the Holy Ghost. Well, let me tell you something. Either it was the wrong formula or they didn't truly repent, because God's Word is not a lie. And when people do it the Bible way, when they come up out of that watery grave, they're going to be filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And if you'll just open your mouth by faith and begin to worship God, there'll be a language change. There is no language barrier in the church. Preacher, I'm scared of it. That's like saying you're scared of God. I'm not talking about the fear of the Lord. That's completely different. The Bible said the beginning of wisdom is the fear of the Lord.
That's right.
I'm talking about being afraid for the Holy Ghost to come into your life. Let me tell you something. It's the best move you'll ever make.
Yes, sir.
It's the best thing that will ever happen to you. It'll bring joy that nothing else can. It'll bring a peace that nothing else is capable of.
Right.
It'll bring a brand new anointing and a go you through in your bosom that when you wake up on Monday, you know, you say, oh no. You jump up and say, hey, let's go. I'm excited about what God, you know what? I want to tell you what sinners do. They get up and say, yay. But apostolics get up and begin to pray and say, God, I thank you for this day that you've given me. Lord, I thank you for a brand new life. Come on, anybody do that? Lord, I thank the Lord. Because the Holy Ghost is necessary.
Yes, sir.
It's not optional. There's a lot of things in this world that may be optional. I don't like to think so, but I'm just going to tell you something. I hope I know I'm not real offensive. I don't like to think that shouting's optional. It probably is. I don't find any scripture in there that says we got to shout. I don't like to think it is, but we'll say that shouting maybe is optional. For me, it's not optional. I'm going to shout.
Amen.
I'm going to bounce my head. Amen. I will look like Shannon Martin sometimes when I get my head going on really good. You don't know who that is. That's one of my friends. Amen. I'm going to bow my head just a little bit and look like him. I'm going to tell you something. Every now and then I might even cut you a good old dido around and get dizzy from it. I'm going to run around the church because that's just who I am. But we might agree that that's optional. There are some other things that might be optional, but I want to tell us tonight the infilling of the Holy Ghost is not optional. You got to have it. And you need it. And you ought to want it. And if you ever get it, I guarantee you that one time won't be enough for you. Somebody asked me, how many of you have it? The whole thing is the church. I said, I don't know for sure, but I know that I got it. He said, I thought you had it already. I said, my God, I make it a point of trying to get it every time. And then the doors are open because I want more of it. This ain't no new quote. Anybody like steak? If I feed you one tonight, you're going to stop eating it. All it's going to make me is hungry for the next one. Yeah. I ain't going to lie. I've been thinking about that dinner barrel, sis. You had one of them steaks the other night, too, man. That was water. I almost spoke in tongues as Brother Lambert would say. I got staggering lips. Amen. I almost spoke in tongues right there at the dinner barrel. My chops, they were bouncing back and forth. You had one, too. But I want to tell you something. It didn't make me. I wasn't satisfied. Every day I thought about that steak, and I thought, my God, the next time hallelujah. I told you I wasn't going to be long, but I just kept on. I can't help it. Amen. I got a Jeff Arnold spirit tonight. Hallelujah. I may close 40 more times. Amen. Brother Arnold's the only man I know that reads his Bible verse and says, I'm closing. And preaches for another hour. Before he says, I'm closing again, and then preaches another hour. Amen. Lord, I hope that they'll get back to him on Facebook. I know he's on Facebook. Brother Arnold, I still love you. God bless you. Amen. Church, we need the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah, we need the Holy Ghost. We gotta have it. It's a necessity. It's one of our greatest tools. It's one of the things that will take us through. Amen. I want it, I've got it, I'm gonna keep it, and I want more of it. Preacher, you greedy when it comes to the Holy Ghost, you better believe it. Amen. Brother Greer used to say it like this, I wanna find the spout where the glory is coming out. Amen. Every time you raise it, and somebody asked him one time, said, Pastor Greer, has that got anything to do with the sign of victory? He said, no, it's a funnel. I want to find that spout where the glory is coming out, and I want to funnel it in. So that God would just pour it all over me, my Lord. To become the house of God. We don't need to be constant out of the way, but we need to find it, and we need to get drenched by it.
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. Come on, lift your hands right now, Lord Jesus God.